Rafael, who's the principal trainer and security specialist at Riscure, and he'll be presenting on CheapSCAte attacking IoT with less than $60.
Oh, thank you for your introduction. So, well, welcome everybody. I would like to start with a little story about IoT and how we captured the flag, a contest. So last year, 2017, according to a Gartner report, 8.4 billion things are connected to the internet. Okay, so nowadays, we live in the IoT world. Your phone is connected to the internet, your TV is connected to the internet, your coffee machine is connected to the internet, your toothbrush is connected to the internet, everything is connected to the internet. Okay, I'm a person which I'm curious by nature, so I always like to know what is inside everything. So if I look at these typical IoT devices, they pack a lot of stuff inside, but they are really cheap. So these devices, they are typically powered by a thing called something microcontroller. It's a general purpose microcontroller. They are really, really cheap, but they do a lot of stuff. They do things like internet, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, memory, USB, you name it. They also pack a lot of sensors to measure the temperature or the humidity or intrusion detection, a lot of stuff. And if you want to even tinker with these things, you have something like a developer kit. They are super cheap. So you can get one packed with a lot of things for less than $20. But I work in a security company. We do a lot of evaluations on embedded systems. And my security analyst brain starts ringing here. I have a lot of features, but this is super cheap. Okay, so what's the catch here? Something is going to go wrong, right? So let me tell you what is wrong. So general purpose microcontrollers are not secure against side channel analysis, SCA, and fault injection attacks, FI. Okay. I will repeat it once more. General purpose microcontrollers are not secure against side channel analysis and fault injection attacks. This is not something new or not something that the industry doesn't know. I mean, manufacturers, they have security lines of processors. In 2015, for example, this is me with a colleague in the CCC conference. I was showing live how could you do fault injection attacks to crack RSA signatures live in the stage, and this was a camera flash. I was just taking a picture at it, and it still broke. Apparently, the message didn't get through there, so I'm going to hammer you with this once again. General purpose microcontrollers are not secure against side channel analysis and fault injection attacks. Okay? So in Riscure, we have a hardware challenge, a contest, it's called a CTF, in which participants, they first do some qualification rounds, and then they get a small board, a hardware board. We actually ship it. So last year, this was IoT themed, and we wanted to see what people are trying to attack these devices. So we had challenges about cryptography, about binary reverse engineering, exploitation, but also we had side analysis and fault injection attacks. So we had a lot of participants, more than 500 all over the world, and yeah, lots of people solved the software challenges, but I was quite disappointed that almost nobody tried this SCA and FI, side analysis and fault injection. So I was very puzzled because, yeah, these devices are quite weak. So I ask around, typical answers I got is things like, yeah, this is super expensive, or this is only for security evaluation labs, or I'm allergic to mathematics, I don't understand this thing, or yeah, my device will blow up, or this is super expensive. Well, I got all sorts of answers. What is my goal today of this presentation? My goal is the following. I would like to show you that side analysis is affordable for anyone. There is no excuse. Fault injection is also affordable for anyone. You will see what it takes to do a fault injection attack. And if you are an IoT developer and you think these things don't apply to me, or I handle sensitive data, but yeah, I'm only concerned about software, or I don't want to try these attacks, it's too complicated, or I don't care about this thing. It is not going to be a question of if, it's going to be a question of when you will get hacked. So please do something. Okay? I'm going to show now how these attacks work, but I'm going to use some ground rules in order to show you that this is for everybody. So my rules for this game are going to be the following. I'm going to use the cheapest I could find off the internet. It's off the shelf. I'm going to use only open source software. So what I'm going to use here is nothing proprietary. You can get it for free. And these things should be reproducible by a script kiddie. Basically, you download the software, you just press some buttons. It doesn't matter if you're a cat or not. You will break this device. Okay, so these are my rules of the game. Let me start now with site analysis attacks, how they work. I first will introduce them, and then I will do a live demo here so you see how it works. So the first challenge of this contest that was for site analysis, it was called Piece of Cake. You can actually download it from GitHub. It's free. The goal was we have a device, an IoT device, and this device, all it does is the following. We send a message. This device encrypts this message, and we get the encrypted message. We don't know the key. It's using AES crypto, so it's using very, very strong crypto. But we would like to get the key. So we will do an SCA attack, and we will see how it works. Just a note, so these attacks, they do not work only on AES. Basically, they work on anything that has crypto. The only requirement is that you have this device. So if you have a device, and inside this device, you have some crypto running in it, that's all you need. Then you can mount these side channel attacks. They are really powerful. OK. So SCA in a nutshell, site analysis, it's four steps, very easy. First step, we need to talk or we need to listen to the device, and the device will do its thing. In this case, cryptography AES. The second thing, we're going to measure the power consumption of this device while it's doing some computation. While it runs crypto, we're going to do this power consumption measurement. After that, we're going to put this data we collected, these power measurements and the data we listened or we sent, into a program, a site analysis attack. This program will run some mathematics, and then we get the key. So this is all you need to know for mounting an ACA attack. The internals of it, it's really not required, but because it's quite easy, I'm going to even explain it so that you can see how it works. Okay. So these are the four steps. Now, how do we do this in practice? Now let's get our hands dirty. So this is, as an attacker, what you would do. First, we need to measure this power consumption by sending some data. Sometimes we need to do some signal processing. I will describe this in some minutes. Optionally, we can even verify if this device leaks information. So we can see, oh, this leaks or this doesn't leak. This is fully optional. I'm going to show it just for you to see how these devices leak. And at the end, we just run the attack. All the data we collected, click the program, go, we're done. So the first question. How do I measure these traces? Okay, so how do I actually measure power? These are the components. We have a computer, and then we have our IoT device. So first, we're going to send some messages or listen to this device, and we need to collect this data. At the same time, we need somehow to measure what is the power consumption of this device. Okay, so we connect something. I will show in a second what we can do. And we use a digitizer. It's called an oscilloscope to record this power consumption. We feed all this data into the computer, we run a program, and then done. This is how the attack works. OK, so how do I actually measure the power? Well, it's really, really easy. You take the power line of this device, you take some scissors, you cut the power line, and then you put something called a resistor. Okay, it's a tiny piece of electronics, and you can measure what is the voltage drop on that thing. With that, you can measure what is the power consumption. This approach actually, we rarely use it in the lab because it has quite some issues. There are much more efficient ways. You can use an antenna. You can use a current probe. But remember my rules of the game. I'm using the cheapest I could find. And a resistor is super cheap. You can get more than 100 resistors by less than a dollar. So OK, resistor. This is the cheapest I could find. We're going to measure the power here. Okay. The rest of the budget. So I used a USB cable to power this IoT device. This I took from the trash can, so free. I'm going to use a soldering iron, a USB-powered one, $4 off the internet. It comes with tin. Amazing. It even works. I was surprised that this even worked. OK. Then I got an oscilloscope. I put it between quotes because I could really not call this oscilloscope. I could call it digitizer. This has no trigger. This is the cheapest I could find. Please buy something else. But this does the work. It comes with cables, free shipping, everything. Great. Then the last thing, I need to talk to this device. So I needed that USB to serial cable. It's $1 shipped to home. OK. Total budget, $59. So that's why this presentation is called CheapSCAte. It's a C from SEA. Notice the pun. So OK, this is what we are going to use. Now, let's go to a demo. OK. So please, now let's switch to my computer. And I'm going to show how this thing looks. So here,
Oops. You can see here in the desk what I have the following. I have, this is the oscilloscope, this tool here, and I have two wires connected to this IoT device. What is here is the following. You can see I have this resistor. I used a really big one for the demo, but typically I use a small one. But this one is just for you to see it. This resistor is connected on this wire. This is just the USB wire that I just cut, and then I just connected the two wires, a resistor in between, and then I plugged this oscilloscope probe. I also have another of these cables from the oscilloscope connected to the LED of this IoT device. Okay? Later I will explain why, but I'm recording both the power consumption of this and also I'm recording what is the LED status. Okay, so now I'm going to close this. And I'm going to first power up this device. 1 second. And I'm going to first, this oscilloscope is so cheap that I have to reprogram every time. So I'm going to just reprogram this oscilloscope to make it working. Okay. So here we can see that it's connected. And I'm going to run a script, which the only thing it does is the following. I'm going to send some message. So you can see here that I'm sending some messages. And I'm getting an encrypted message. I don't have no clue of what is the key, but this is what is happening. I send a random message. I get an encrypted message. At the same time, in this script, I'm starting a toolkit called Sigrok to capture the power consumption over the resistor. OK? Done. This is how you capture power. Can we see it? Yes, we can. So let me open one of these traces, for example, the first one, and see what's happened. Okay. So here, not too much to see. OK, so you can see the yellow line. I'm going to make it a bit bigger. The yellow line, this is the power consumption over the resistor. This purple line, this one is the activity of the LED. You can already notice that when this LED is on, the power consumption is quite high. And in here, we have some patterns. For those of you that are experienced with cryptography, you might already start recognizing that here we have a repeating pattern. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 patterns. What is this? For those of you well-versed in cryptography and AES, AES is a crypto system that has 10 rounds. It does 10 times the same thing. That's actually what we are already seeing. Okay, so this is how you measure power at the same time we collected the data. OK, let's go back to the presentation. OK. Can we go back to the presentation slides? Yes, thank you. So the next thing is signal processing. Do we need to do something to improve the signal? So in order to run the mathematics, we need to compare apples to apples. That means that when we capture data, the things need to be aligned, because then we can start comparing if the peaks are higher or lower. Okay? So this device, it starts the crypto at a bit random time, but it has a blinky LED. IoT devices have a blinky LED. You like these LEDs blinking when you do something. So this device, the LED is on when this device, this IoT AES crypto, starts running. So I'm going to align with that. I'm going to use that fact to start aligning all the computations. Okay? Let's go back to my computer, and I'm going to show you what is going on. Okay, so we have this. Now, I can open another one so that you see what is happening. Let's open, for example, the second one. Okay, and now here, so this one starts a bit later. This is around 500 and something microseconds. The previous one, it's around 400 and something microseconds. You see that they don't start at the same time. But in both cases, I do have this blinky LED. Okay? This signal is on. So I'm going to trim the traces just at the beginning, just here, because that's all I need for this power consumption. In order to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to run a script, which all it does is the following. This script is going to try to detect where this start of the blinky LED happens when I have this signal, This in electronics is called a trigger signal. And if I find this LED on, then I'm going to clip a part of these measurements. I'm just going to keep, every time I see the blinking LED on, I'm going to capture it. Why? Because I know that this device is doing some crypto. Okay? So now this will take a while, okay? Because I captured some traces. So let's leave this running, and let's go back to the presentation. So while this is running, I'm going to show you one thing which is fully optional. But does this device leak? Okay. We can run statistics, we can run mathematics if we want to show that there is leakage. You can use any statistical package like R or SciPy or Octave to compute statistics. A useful statistic to compute leakage is something called the Welch t-test. There's a methodology called TVLA that uses this. This test, this Welch t-test, what it does is telling us if from the power consumption, I can tell apart random messages from not random messages, from constant. So here, what you see in this graph, on the horizontal domain, that's time. On the vertical domain is the certainty we have that there is leakage. This is measured in something called standard deviations. When you have 4.5 standard deviations, we are 99.999, so 5/9, sure that there is leakage. Here, the red line, it's 4.5. So we are not 5/9 sure. We are a gazillion 9 sure that this is leakage. Okay, so this is the typical behavior of these microcontrollers. This is what happens, because they are not secure against such analysis and fault injection. Okay, so it leaks, yeah, but this is optional. The last step. How do I attack? How do I get profit as an attacker? So I will explain a bit the attack in depth, but do not worry if you don't get it now, because you don't need to understand it. Just run the program. It does all the work. Okay? If you want to understand it later, you can see these slides. You can revisit the presentation. And eventually, this will click. So what happens is the following. Here, we're going to attack AES. And AES is a crypto system which is called a block cipher. It takes blocks of data and encrypts them. This key is chopped in subkeys, and these subkeys are used independently, and we can run an attack in blocks. So what does it mean? It means the following. We have the input message, we have the key. We don't use all the key at once. So these 128 bits we don't use at once. We're using these tiny pieces of 8 bit. Therefore, what I can do is the following. I can guess parts of the key, and if the key is right, I can see if the power consumption has a certain behavior. So what we're going to do is a divide and conquer approach. Brute forcing the key is impossible. But trying to attack this thing in these little chunks, in these byte by byte, I can do that. Because I have 16 of these bytes. And trying all the possibilities for a byte, for 8 bits, is 2 to the power 8. It's 256 keys. So in the end, I only have to try 4,096 keys, and I'm done. This is all I have to do. I reduced an impossible situation, 2 to the power 128, to 4,096 attempts. As you will see, this takes seconds. So, okay, this cipher and all modern ciphers are public. So if I can guess this part of the key, I can start rebuilding this algorithm, and I can find what are these values that happen. Do I have a means to compare this computation, these guesses I have, to the power consumption? Okay, let's ask the internet. And then Happy Cat says yes. So yes, we can compare. How does this work? It works as follows. It's a correlation power analysis attack. Basically, from the input, we guess part of the key, we reveal this algorithm, we get some values. Then we make an assumption of the power consumption of this device. For example, I don't know, if I have more ones, the power is higher. If I have less ones, the power is lower. The more ones I have, the more power. This model is called the Hamming weight model. And then what we use is this data and the power consumption to compare. We're going to run something called correlation. If the two things move in sync, then that means that there is some dependency, there is some correlation. So we run it for this data and the first point in time, for this data and the second point in time, in this power consumption. We run it for all the time, basically. Eventually, you can see in the middle that there is a spike in correlation. Why? Because this data, for example, Hamming weight 8 is high, the power consumption in the middle is high. Hamming weight 5, medium high, power consumption in the middle is high. Hamming weight 2, that's low. Hamming weight, so the power consumption in the middle is low. There is some dependency. That means that I'm using those values in that device. Therefore, if I have a correct key guess,
I can recompute the internal state, and I compare to reality, and it matches, I know that what I have guessed is actually the reality. So I'm going to now show this. Okay, let's go back to my computer. Okay, so this should have enough traces now. So what I'm going to do is I am going to run this attack. This is a toolkit called Julia ICA, which is actually open source and is made by one of my colleagues in Riscure. And what this thing does is the following. I have provided this toolset, these chopped traces, these power measurements when they start at the LED, and what was the input and output. Now, this is trying to guess every single key byte, and it's trying to compare against the power consumption. Okay, so you see that this is now running some mathematics. You really don't need to understand what is going. Boom. That's the key of this device, AES-128. Military-grade crypto, broken in 15 seconds. So this is the power of SEA. This is all open source. If you want to learn a bit more what happened, you can see that if, for example, I tag the last key byte, if I use this key value, the match with reality, this correlation is 0.46. The next best guess is 0.30. So there is one of these key values that matches reality better than the rest. And this happens also for the key byte 15, and this happens also for all the key bytes. This is what a successful attack looks like. So the conclusions. Let's go back to the slides, please. So the first takeaway is that I used the cheapest equipment I could find, and I could still break this IoT device. The total cost of everything I used is less than $60. I always get the question, how about time? How much time does it take to do this thing? Well, I took 2 days to do the full attack, so from start to end. And most of the time actually was because I was fighting this oscilloscope. Okay, so this is not the best thing. If I used a bit better equipment, like if I spent 100 euros, I get something called hardware trigger on the scope, then this is 2 hours. If I use professional tooling, this is 2 minutes. But this is from start to end. If I want to repeat this attack now, then I just need to go to the internet, get this equipment, plug it in, 2 minutes, you're done. So these attacks now, they scale quite good. You just need to download, run, go, boom. The second takeaway from here is that this open source software for such analysis is getting really good. So even some people that do professional tools, they do share these things as a hobby. There is quite some tools about this. So yes, I think now, hopefully you can see that such analysis for everybody. Let's look now at a different thing. Let's look at fault injection. Okay, let's look at theory and application. I'm going to use a different challenge of this Riscure Hack Me contest to illustrate how it works. Here we have this IoT device, and what this device does is the following. This device boots, and then it keeps printing lock, lock, lock. It's in lock state. Okay, you can imagine your door lock that is just lock, and you would like to do something to unlock it. This is exactly the same scenario. So to do the attack, this fault injection attack, first I need to make a guess of what's going on. So I made a hypothesis, what is running on this device? And in here, I guess that what's happening is the following. What I have is something like, this is not unlocked, some variable, unlocked false. Then this chip boots and starts printing this I/O. And there is an infinite loop. Everything what it's doing is something like, is this unlocked? No, then print it's locked. Is this unlocked? Yes, then do something. I don't know what's happening, but this is my guess. It's running always, and if it's not unlocked, then it prints lock. Okay? So a fault injection attack, all it does is corrupt the program execution, either the order of operations or the data. It's basically we are going to introduce noise in one of these devices, and then the device will just get corrupted. Okay? It gets a bit crazy. So what could we glitch here? We could try, for example, changing this unlocked variable to see, oh, now you're unlocked. Magically, this could happen. We could try to corrupt the CPU to do something strange. We could try to skip instructions to make maybe this check is not done. This are you unlocked? Maybe this is not done, and I print the secret. So this is all theories. In the end, what did I glitch? Anybody dare to guess? Well, this is the answer. I don't care. As an attacker, this is a really unfair game for the developer.
because all I care is that I print the secret. I don't care what the fault is doing, as long as I end up printing this secret, as long as I just unlock this device, I do not care how this works. You can imagine that as a developer, this is a nightmare, because there are a lot of ways to end up in that code by corrupting this. OK, so now, how can I actually do fault injection? Then the simplest attack you can think of is something called voltage glitching. In the power line, I will start putting noise, some spikes, and see what happens. Then this device is not really fast. So this device was working at 16 megahertz. So the time for attacking the clocks is 62.5 nanoseconds. For modern standards, that's actually quite slow. Okay, so we have tooling which is much faster than that. And then I did a brainstorm of this fault injection setup. Like, I don't know, I could take one microcontroller, some transistors, some power supplies. I could take something called a DAC and two buffers and see what happens. OK, let's keep to the rules. So here, I need to use the cheapest I could find. So then I made one device, which I nicknamed the cheapo glitcher. So this is basically, I went to one of these conferences, like here. And I just got a free development board, an IoT device. Yay, great, free. If you want to buy the same device I used, it's actually $15, and it's a developer kit. So this device has something called GPIO, General Purpose Input Output. And this device, you can toggle these pins quite fast. Okay? The maximum speed is 90 megahertz, which is way faster than this IoT device. These pins, these input-output pins, actually have quite some power to power these IoT devices. IoT devices are typically low power. So you just connect the input-output to this IoT device, and it powers up. Great. All I'm going to do is the following. I'm going to just try the most crazy thing I could think of, which is just plug the power supply to these input-output pins and send garbage, send random messages. Because these output pins are 3.3 volts, it should power the device. Let's see what happens. Will it even work? Okay, so this I actually made a bet with my colleagues. And then there was last summer, there was a conference in Amsterdam. And after some high caffeine drinks, this is what happened after 5 hours. So what you see in the screen is actually the result of plugging this developer board to this chip. And I was just outputting garbage. At a certain point, I noticed that the chip was saying, hey, chip unlocked. This is the flag for this challenge. And you can see that after I found this garbage that seemed to work, I could actually spam this garbage every time. And then every single time, I was unlocking the device. I was 100% successful to unlock this device. And this is only 5 hours of effort. So what is the takeaway here for fault injection? Well, the first thing, I was surprised. It works with anything. Okay, so this is the cheapest I could find. You can even choose one of these IoT devices to glitch another of these IoT devices. I don't know how you can get cheaper than that. So the first thing, because you can glitch with anything, you should be aware of this fact. If you just buy two of these IoT devices, they are also powerful enough to glitch other devices. You don't need to buy extra stuff. The second thing is countermeasures for fault injection, because it's that easy, it's a must. So the attack was possible because this was running an infinite loop. It was always checking if it's unlocked. I was spamming garbage. And somehow, magically, I spam some magic garbage that tricked this chip to always say it's unlocked. But these structures, this infinite loop, this always repeating, it's very common in software. Do you have such a structure? Like, I have some interconnection, I verify that this is fine. If it's not fine, I get stuck. Okay? These things is, again, this infinite loop structure, really easy to glitch. Do you have such a thing in your code? So my conclusions and the takeaways from this presentation. My goals today were to show you that SCA is affordable for anyone. I hope I managed to show that. Also, I wanted to show that fault injection is affordable to anyone. I used a free board, and it also worked. I also had a third goal, which is, as a developer, should you do something? Instead of saying, yeah, I show this, I want to throw a couple of questions to the audience. So do you know the answer to these questions? Regarding SCA, am I certain that my device does not leak information with sidechannel attacks?
For fault injection, do I know if my device, the security of it, cannot be bypassed with a fault injection attack? If you don't know this thing, now you know that such an attacks are available for everybody. Fault injection attacks are available for everybody. Your take. My recommendation is to do the following. The first thing, so as soon as possible, try to understand this threat. There is a lot of documentation about how such analysis and fault injection attacks work. You can take a training from us, from other companies. There is a lot of information. You can do a lot of stuff, but please try the attacks yourself. You will be surprised how easy and how powerful they are nowadays. After you understand how these things work, then try to implement a solution, develop something. What I showed here, this is just the tip of the iceberg. This is using the cheapest of the cheapest. The modern attackers, if they don't spend $60, but they spend $1,000, you would be amazed how easy it is to attack high-end devices. Okay, so this is how, for example, video games consoles get hacked. Recently, last month, a very popular one got hacked with a really, really cheap glitch. Once you do develop a solution, this, remember that it's not only at the hardware or software, this is at several levels. So at the design, at the software, and the hardware. Okay? And there are some nice design patterns. So here I included a link to a website in which you can find documentation on how to do this, because it's not easy, it's not trivial, but it can be done. After you develop a solution, then verify it. This is something that it's not trivial to implement. Once you make a design, this is the crypto, it should be fine, and you then implement it, compilers can do strange things, can remove your countermeasures or defenses. The design can differ from the implementation. So make sure that what you test is what you have in the field. Test it. This is something that vulnerabilities, they just pop up out of nowhere. This is something that in our evaluations we see a lot of time. And independent testing here, a lab or a team dedicated to this could help a lot on finding these nasty vulnerabilities. Okay. So this was my presentation. Thank you for your attention. And thanks to my fiance for bearing with me for preparing this thing. I will be very happy to take your questions now.
Hi, Rafael. Nice talk. Thank you very much. You're making me want to get back to my workshop. But just as a broader point for the audience, so a lot of these attacks require physical access or owning the hardware in order to be able to manipulate it.
Yes.
So in order for the attacks to be scalable, you need hard-coded keys that are reused across devices. Do you see that across IoT devices reusing the same crypto? And if so, do you see a divergence between consumer IoT and devices like medical devices or industrial IoT?
So the question is, in here, to scale the attack, we need to have the same key across devices. So do I see this in IoT for consumer or for industrial? The thing is, this really depends. It's not industry specific. This really depends on the implementation. In the end, here we can scale the attack in two ways. One is finding out the key on a device, and then the same key works for all. But if you have devices that have different key, one key per device, the power of these attacks nowadays is that it's really cheap to mount this attack. Once you find the attack path, then you can just say, hey guys, this is how you break it. Download these scripts. And it doesn't matter then that you have key per device. You can now easily scale the attack.
OK, thank you.
Hi, thanks for your presentation. A lot of these attacks require physical access. How much more would it cost to do it remotely? Like from a farther distance, like if you wanted to hit someone's Fitbit from 20 feet instead of actually direct access, can you do the same thing with that?
It's a very good question. So the question was, here these attacks require physical access. Can we do these attacks remotely from a distance? The answer is yes. So there are two flavors of this attack. One flavor of it is called Tempest attacks, which basically you can, with an antenna from quite some distance, measure the power consumption, and you can still attack these devices. But there is also something quite recent, which is this Spectre and Meltdown attacks. So these attacks, if you look at them, they are actually side-channel attacks, but in software. Instead of measuring the power consumption, we are measuring the time it takes to do some operations. But it's exactly the same principles here. So Spectre and Meltdown, actually, they are hardware attacks which are exploited only by using software, but they rely on hardware vulnerabilities. Okay, so yes, these attacks, they can be much more sophisticated. You have this Meltdown, you have these Spectre attacks, they are still side-channel attacks. That's why it's so important to understand how these attacks work, because they have a lot of flavors.
And as a part two, how much more expensive would it cost for that?
Sorry, come again?
So this, it's based around doing like a cheap to do these attacks. How much more would you think that doing a remote attack would cost?
It really depends on what is the implementation. If you have a device that is vulnerable to a Spectre attack or a Meltdown attack, it takes the time of the developer, of the attacker, how to craft this attack. How much it is, I do not know. This depends on the expertise. Okay, but this is something that depends on your attacker and also on the tooling you use.
Thank you.
So your example was the power glitching on a very simple black box implementation. But do you see that, like, it seems like very probabilistic. So you waited 5 hours and you got an answer. Like, how long would it take on, have you seen on a real, like, IoT device, like something that's not just a simple if while, like, inside a while loop? And also, like, is black box, like, in that case, if you want to do something like a timing attack, you can't do it black box, I assume, because you need to know very clearly the timing of each assembly instruction.
So the question here is it very difficult to do this on a device which is much more competent than this if? And also, do we have to have some insight into the software to mount these timing attacks? Mm-hmm. So here, you have to take into account that this is a structure just to illustrate what is going on in the device. The actual code is a lot more complicated. And as an attacker, you just have to have a goal in mind, like I want to bypass the security check. You really do not need to know how this works. This is actually what we try even with higher security products. We just have a guess. It can be very convoluted what is happening inside the device, but you just try. It's like playing the lottery. Sometimes you will get closer to what is the check, and then you might get lucky. And in some cases, you will get lucky all the times if you find the certain configuration that works. For timing attacks, do we need to have some insight? It's also based on educated guesses. But you can imagine that the device, for example, might behave differently if it's locked or unlocked. So what I can do is take a device, just know the key, know how it behaves unlocked, then lock this device, take some measurements, see how this device behaves locked, and it's very easy to spot these two scenarios, even if I have no idea of what is running inside the device. This already gives you quite some step to mount these side channel analysis and fault injections attacks.
Thank you.
Hi. So there's been some work in academia on side channel resistant algorithms. I think NSA Simon is one example. And I'm wondering if you see those being deployed or there's any you'd recommend to developers to use in their products?
Yeah. So the question is, there are some side-channel analysis resistant algorithms, and do we see them deployed? So it's a very good question. For these IoT devices, you focus on performance and getting things work on really constrained systems. If you start putting countermeasures, the first thing that you have to pay is in performance, because these algorithms typically are more expensive. There are some of these algorithms which might not pay a big penalty, but this is a very active research topic. Then again, for connecting to the internet or for doing some things, you have to still rely to the old standards, like going to RSA or AES. So it is not the device that we don't see a push for having these algorithms. It's more that in order to connect to the internet, you need to rely on older algorithms. And then if you start putting countermeasures, these become very slow. Therefore, it might not be secure. So it is difficult to deploy such solutions, but we see the effort from academia and from industry to push them.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, if there are no more questions, then thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, you can also grab me anytime during the conference. Thank you.